Hallelujah. Praise God. Just a couple of things before I begin to share with you tonight. Appreciate you all who people are giving towards the land, that we need land for the Jewish people. And people, quite a lot of people say, well, can we come and see it when you get it? The answer is no. It has to be completely hidden, even from satellite view. We're not telling anyone the location once we have it and get things set up, for obvious reasons, you know. And I guess I hope you understand that. And you know, and even the buildings we build on there will be camouflaged, so you cannot see them from the sky. The eye in the sky is everywhere. Hallelujah. You know, when this whole thing starts and the world starts to fall apart, the Jewish people are going to be blamed again for everything. And they're going to be hunted down, especially Jewish people outside of Israel, in this nation. They're going to be hunted down. And other nations around the world, you know. And as you've done it unto, Jesus said, unto the least of these, my brethren, the Jewish people, you have done it unto me. So, I just wanted you to understand that we can't share everything because of stuff needs to be hidden, you know. And that's important. I'm going to get my wife to talk to you in a moment. And, you know, we've been married. ...51 years. This year. And she's older than me. By 3 months. We both turned 73 this year. So, I've been in the ministry full time for 45 years. So we're still here. You know, my wife has a lot of dreams, particularly dreams which for her to pray, you know. And she's not an upfront person anymore. You know, she used to run very large ladies' meetings on a weekly basis, over 600 ladies each week. And did that for years, and then when, you know, we moved on and finally retired from the ministry, she just wanted to have a secluded life and pray. And she's had some incredible encounters, particularly in dreams, from the Lord. And recently she had a dream, and it was about children. And the Lord in the dream began to speak to her about children, how they're in danger, and particularly the children of Christians. She was clearly shown in the dream that the enemy was going to start targeting them, and how we need prayer to cover them in the schools from sexual abuse and all kinds of other abuse in the schools. You know, when they're out of the home, you almost lose control of them, and they need to be covered. And she was getting annoyed in the dream because the people, she was going to take a meeting and speak at this meeting, but the people were just flippant and weren't listening. And you know, it was a kind of a picture of, she felt, of the church at this present time. They're not aware of the danger. And so, Mark, my son, and I, we'd been working in the studio all day from 6 in the morning, and she was very, very tired. And we're just about to pack up, Martha Sun says, why don't you, we film you and you share your dream? And she said, no, my hair's not good. And she was really, really tight. She said, look, I'm too tired to even think. And I said, look, you've got your dream book here. And anyway, we filmed her, and she was a little kind of, she had to think clearly, and she stuttered a bit because she was just tired. And she said, you're not sending that to Lancaster. Anyway, I sneaked it out. And so just understand, because she's hesitant, she has to think about what she's saying, but get the spirit of it. If you guys are ready to show that, and we'll dim the lights a bit and we'll just have a look. Okay. Oh, it's all right, I'll stand. I'm fine. No sound.
Thank you for the way you've looked after
the bucket up.
Supported us in our ministry. Hello, Lancaster. Just wanted to send a personal greetings to you and send my love. And big thank you for the way you've looked after Neville and supported us in our ministry. And also a big thank you to Joe and Melinda for their love to us. And Sadhu, Neville's good friend. And to our new friend, Andy, from England. So I want to say hi to you all and God bless you. Also, I'd like to just say how wonderful it is and how blessed we are to live in a country where it's the Christian country, and that we're able to accept Christ and to come to wonderful conferences like you folks are in at the moment. Because I think of people in other lands who bow down to idols, thinking that's the true way. But how blessed we are to have the true and living way. And I'm also very grateful to the Lord because He gives me dreams on what He wants me to pray for. So I'd like to just share one of the dreams with you. And I'm also going to read it from the book that I wrote it in when I got out of bed. So I just want you to feel the spirit of the dream. This is the beginning of the dream. I was in a house waiting to speak. Only approximately six women and their children were there. I thought, that's not many people. But gradually the people came in, and they were talking loud as they came in, and a man showed them to their seats. I was sitting at a small table up the front, and people were sitting and standing besides me. There was a lot of disruption. People that weren't interested, and they talked loud, and they were not settling down. And suddenly I stood to my feet and banged the table three times. And I said, I'm not normally a demonstrative person, and spoke about child abuse and the evil of it. What can we do, you might ask? This is still in the dream. We can form a prayer group and pray against these demons. The Lord needs us and can't work without us. He needs us to be part of this. The heart of God is grieved for the way the children are being treated in places. I awoke with the Holy Spirit upon me, and I prayed and interceded for the children. And I just thought I'd love to share that with you this morning, and maybe just give a little challenge to you out there, that you might stand with me and sit at the table with me and pray for these children. I just thought we could be either that or like the women that were coming in, not interested about anything but their own selves, talking loud, didn't care that they were disrupting the meeting. And I just want to challenge you that under the blessing of the pastor and his wife, maybe there's a home there that a woman feels that they would like to open just for an hour a week where others can come and pray for the abused children, verbally, physically, sexually, and also those who have abused at school and bullied. This is very much on my heart. And I just want to leave that with you as just a small message to say, I'd love you to join with me. I'm only one person, and I'd love you to join with me to pray for these children. Jesus said, suffer the little children to come unto me, such as the kingdom of God, and forbid them not. The disciples wanted to get them out of the way because he felt they weren't important. But Jesus said, suffer the children to come to me. I love them. Well, Lancaster, have a wonderful conference. I'll be thinking of you and certainly praying. Lots of love from me.
Not bad for 73-year-old, you know. One thing she forgot to tell you, the Lord spoke to her in the dream and said, please tell the people to pray. It's very important. And it's on the Lord's heart, you know. The children are going to be targeted. That's the coming army, you know. And the enemy is putting together programs to target the children. And so, you know, we need to pray, and we need to believe God to keep them safe. And particularly it was for children of Christian families. The target was against. And so we need to continue to pray. Hallelujah. Praise God. Let me see that clock. Okay. No, I just need to... Don't say that. I've got a whole book here. yes. Well, difficult times. You know, the theme of this whole conference has been the same. We're living in the end times, difficult times. Things are not going to be easy, you know. But God knows what he's doing. You know, the question is, you know, often asked, even by Christians, is God in control of everything? Well, you know, there's been numerous earthquakes over the last couple of years, countless tragedies, children have died, the wars are raging, there's always a number of wars, anytime. At the moment and any time happening in the world. And is God in control? You know? Where is he? Why doesn't he intervene? You know? We first need to have within our hearts and minds that God has not lost control of anything. God is in control. He allows what he allows, Because what he allows, even in judgment, it is redemptive for Christ to bring people back to him. As Pastor Joe was saying this morning, and all the other speakers have been saying the same thing, you know. We need to understand that a major theme in God's Word is the throne of God. You find it all the way through the Word of God. The throne of God, which implies power, authority, and control. It's like Psalm 103 and verse 19. It says, the Lord hath prepared his throne in the heavens, and his kingdom rules over everything. From his throne, he rules over everything. That's pretty clear, isn't it? God is in control. He's ruling over everything. You know, Ecclesiastes 1 and verse 4 says, one generation comes and then the generation passes away. Then comes another generation that passes away. There's wars, there's famines, there's good things, there's bad things. But the earth abides forever and God remains in control. There's only one thing that is constant in the world today, that is God and his throne. That's the only constant. He is in control. And we need this embedded in our spirit. When things start to get bad, God is still in control. And we need to understand that. He remains unmoved, and he never changes. God's plans and purposes cannot be defeated. We've read the last chapter of the book. It cannot be defeated. He said, you know, in Psalm 83, verse 34, he said, 89, 34, my covenant I will not break nor alter the thing that I have said. You know, Malachi 3, 6, God said, I am the Lord and I never change. Isn't that incredible? I'm the Lord. I never change, never has, and never will. He is constant. He remains stable, true, and cannot be moved. Aren't you glad of all that? Yeah. You know, recently, on our property, I was looking at a huge tree, you know, a tree which was just about this height when Jesus was walking the earth. That's how old it is. Massive tree. And I looked at this tree, you know, and it's seen generations come, it's seen generations go, it stands there surveying everything. Generations come, storms come, it's still there. I thought, that's just like God, you know, it reminds me of God. Been around since Jesus was on the earth, you know, and it's like, wow. Some massive storms, hurricanes, still there. Like the throne of God, you know. Still stands, quietly surveying everything, unmoved. In times of crisis and change, God would want us to remember he's on the throne. You know, the prophet Isaiah lived in incredibly difficult days. He ended up being sawn in two, sawn right in half, Isaiah. He lived in very difficult days. And in the difficult days, it got worse when the king died. And he said, he said this in Isaiah 6:1, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting high and lifted up on his throne. God showed him the throne. He was saying, Isaiah, I'm still in control. I've got everything in hand. And his train filled the temple. You know, the Apostle John lived in dangerous times. They boiled him in oil and he wouldn't boil. Josephus records this. You know, it's recorded through history. They couldn't get rid of him. So they put him on the Isle of Patmos, which was a jail, but there was no jailers. It was a jail for the insane, criminally insane, the whole island. That's the island he was on. And he said, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. Hallelujah. Immediately I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat upon the throne. In the midst of this chaos on the Isle of Patmos and criminals all around him, he showed him the throne of God. He's saying, I'm in control. I'm with you. I'm in control. And we need that embedded, you know, in our spirit in times of crisis and change. God has always revealed himself as sitting upon a throne, you know, and his affairs in the earth are administered from the throne of God. 10,000 was generated around the throne, 10,000 and thousands of angels at his command. Enough to keep control of everything. You ask, well, you know, if God's in control, why do bad things happen? Because humans have free will. And he's given the earth to them. But he limits. There is a limit to what he allows. And of course, free will and the problem of sowing and reaping. What is sown will be reaped. That's a universal law throughout the universe. Sowing and reaping. And so we have all of that in the mix today. The sowing from every past generation, good and evil, is coming home today. We're going to see that reaped in this generation. It's a mind-boggling thought, you know. Bible says fools, because of their transgressions and because of their iniquities, are afflicted. You know, God says, if don't do this, because if you do this, you're going to hurt yourself, right? That's what he does. So he gives us laws. Don't go across these boundaries, because if you do that, you're going to hurt yourself and hurt others. You know, it's like you have a little kid, Mark, when he was a little boy, we had a heater, and I said, don't touch the heater. It's going to hurt. You guess what? They only learn after they've touched it. You know, how many of you know he never touched it again? So God lets you touch something, and you get hurt. And then he said, why? There's a reason for those rules. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. You know, whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. You see? So we need to be aware of that. I was driving in, coming in here in the car tonight, and the Lord was saying, tell them about the throne. Tell them I'm on the throne. He is on the throne. It looked like in America, everything's going crazy. God is on the throne. And everything that God does, you know, how can I explain? God is the kindest person I have ever met. And he cannot be other than who he is. You hear what I'm saying? Whatever he does, it has to be out of kindness. Because that's who he is. And if he allows judgment, it is because he is kind. Okay? To stop people going to hell, he'll let them hurt themselves to bring them to themselves. That's kindness. This is the only method he has left, you know. He's incredibly kind. You know, I had an experience just a little while back. I had this angel come to me, and he comes to me regularly. His name is Manoah. And when I looked it up in the Hebrew, it means peaceful. And whenever I'm going to face something difficult, he comes with me. You know, very interesting. And he's become a real friend, you know. And anyway, one morning he came to me and he said, we need to go somewhere. And I said, oh, okay. How many of you know there are portals in the realm of the spirit? Okay. And they do change, you know, and they're different for each one of us. And the first time he appeared to me, He said, come. You know, he's a very friendly angel. And he said, come. So when I said, okay, I wasn't here anymore. And I was walking down this sandy track about this wide, beautiful countryside. And we were walking down this track for quite a long way until we came to a waterfall. And we came right up to the waterfall, and I looked at the angel, and the path had stopped. And he said to me, well, go on. And I said, go on where? He said, come with me. We walked straight through that waterfall into the second heaven. He said, we won't stay here for long. We're just on our way somewhere else. And I came out in the very far, one of the farthest reaches of paradise. And there were these, I don't know if you saw one of the episodes of that Star Wars movies. Oh, everybody thinks I'm backslidden now. But they had this like village town that was all domed, you know, like looked like clay. And can you remember that? Don't tell me. Anyway, it was like, and they looked like very living in poverty, you know, these mud kind of dome things. And I came out and there was a village like that. Like, a bit bigger than a village, but a village like that. But the domes were beautiful. I mean, really finished fabulously. And I said, can I look inside? He said, go inside. And so I walked inside. Inside was done beautifully, beautifully laid out. Wasn't a mansion, wasn't huge, but it was beautiful. And there were the people there, and some of these people were tending orchards and stuff like that. And I said to the angel, I have never seen anything like this in heaven before. These do not look like mansions that I had in my mind and I've seen before. What is this? He said, well, he said, these people had never ever heard the gospel. And he said, when they died, the Lord appeared to them and gave them a choice. And he said, they accepted me. It's going to mess your theology up now. And I said, really? I said, scripture. He said, haven't you read the book of John? This is the light that lighteth every man that cometh into this world. I said, yeah, I knew that. Every person who dies who've never heard of the gospel, the Lord will appear to them at the point of death and give them an opportunity. God is just and God is fair. And the scripture says, this is condemnation, that light has come, and they either reject it or receive it. Right? You with me now? And I thought, man, how good is God? There's so little we understand. How good is the Lord? You know? They're on the very lowest level. And they can proceed maybe a little bit further on that level. I don't know. The angel never told me any more about that. But at least they got there. Didn't make it in the Sons of God class, but at least they're there. Isn't God good? You know? Now I'll get hundreds of emails about that now. How did we get into that? Oh yes, God is good. Then this angel took me further on, and where I met my brother, which I never knew I had. You know, God is really good. He's kind. He cannot be anything other than who he is. That's the issue. And he's kind. So everything he does has to come out of a motivation of kindness. He's long-suffering. He's gentle. He's happy. One of the happiest persons I know. Revelation 12:10. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now has come salvation and strength and the kingdoms of our God and the power of his Christ. Now who is this person, his Christ? I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now has come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. That word Christ is Christos, his anointed ones. And now has come the power of his anointed ones, for the accuser of the brethren is cast down, which accused them, his anointed one, day and night. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto death. You know, one of the things the church has gotten away from is the old basic foundations, the old truths. The church has sanitized the Word of God to make it acceptable to this generation. And it's got to stop. And they overcame him by the blood. What does that mean? You know, we plead the blood. What's that mean? They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. What is that? Well, every time God takes you through something and you overcome it and you're victorious over it, you have an testimony on the inside. And when you're faced with that problem again, say, I've got a testimony. This is how God does it. I can overcome this. I've done it before. The word of their testimony. And so God takes you through one thing after another, so you have an internal testimony after testimony after testimony. You start to run out of money and there's nothing in the cupboard. I've got a testimony. I've been through this. I can trust God. I can overcome. The word of their testimony. They overcame the enemy and they loved not their lives unto death. They were willing to lay their lives down at any cost. They overcame by the blood of the Lamb. Therefore rejoice, Revelation 12:12. Therefore rejoice, you heavens, and you that dwell in them. Woe unto the inhabitants of the earth. And the seal for the devil has come down, and the sea for the devil has come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knows his time is short. And when the dragon saw that he was cast unto the earth, he persecuted the woman which brought forth the man child. About, well, I don't know how long this was, Sadhu. I think you were in Egypt somewhere. Anyway. Two years ago, I saw this beast coming up out of the Mediterranean Sea, and it was a part dragon, part like octopus, had tentacles that stretched into the commerce, stretched into the education system, tentacles, every aspect of this world. But particularly the education, has a very strong tentacle into the educational systems, financial systems of the world, commerce, everywhere this thing was. And I looked at this creature, and I began to pray, because I didn't feel there was something which was not right about this. It was coming up out of the sea. And I said, Lord, this cannot be yet. And people must have been praying elsewhere, I don't know, because it fell back into the Mediterranean Sea. It's coming up again. And this time it will not fall back. I'm telling you, these tentacles, this one world government, these tentacles are going to go into every aspect of society. But they overcame by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto death. So, it says here, you know, then in Revelation 12, it says this dragon was waiting for the birth of a child called a man-child, right? You remember this? Waiting for the birth, waiting for it to be delivered. Okay? And the woman, the church. You know, people, let me just say this. People say, well, this was talking about Jesus. That's absolute rubbish. I mean, it's not even logical, never mind scriptural. This is talking about the end times. This wasn't talking about the birth of Jesus. You know, Jesus wasn't called up to heaven. He was taken into Egypt, place of safety. Okay, now we've got that straight. This man-child, group of people have come to maturity before the others, is caught up to the throne. This is not the rapture or a rapture. They are caught up to the throne to receive assignments. These are overcomers, forerunners. And when they come back down to the earth, they come through the second heaven. And Satan is cast out into the earth. You see, understand what I'm saying? This is what the scripture says. And they were cast out into the earth. When the dragon saw he was cast out into the earth, he persecuted the woman, the church, which brought forth the man-child. Okay. And it says, then great eagle caught away the woman into a wilderness, not a literal wilderness, but a place of safety for times and half a time, 3.5 years. What's the eagle? I have always heard, you know, America's the eagle, so America will say to them, hey, this is the prophetic ministry, the eagles. The eagle, prophetic ministry is going to help the church. The 3.5 years perfecting of the bride. It's going to help feed the bride in the wilderness, literally, not just spiritually. This wilderness, there will be people underground everywhere. And suddenly these overcomers will appear. And they'll bring food and they'll bring water, they'll help them and they'll assist them until the bride is finally coming ready. Hallelujah. But they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, the word of their testimony. We have not yet entered into the fullness of Passover. We think we have. You know, we know Passover, we're saved, we're born again, hallelujah. Well, they came out of Egypt and there was not one sick person among them. We haven't come there yet. Not only sick, a lot of these people were old and they've been in slavery for 300 years. You might be in a genetic condition of these. Has it passed on to generation after generation? You know? And they have to pack up everything and head out of Egypt. It wasn't like the movie, you know, carrying grandma on their shoulders. She was up front marching away. There was not one feeble person among them. That means all of them. Not one feeble person among them, the Bible says. Hey, that's Passover. We haven't got to the fullness of Passover yet, but it's coming. Do you believe it? Yes. If you believe it, then it's true for you. If you don't believe it, then it's not true for you. So it's about time we started to believe it. Not one feeble person among them. Oh, blood. You know, the devil through history has tried to water down Passover in incredible ways. Why does the devil hate Passover so much? You know? The Bible tells us the life of the flesh is in the blood. I'm redeemed by the blood of the Lamb out of the hand of the enemy. Do you believe that? The good news is God's restoring the fullness of Passover back to the church. But it's a battle. It's a battle over the blood. You know, Satan wants to give us a bloodless religion. And so the church sanitizes it. Make it acceptable. Don't talk about blood. But they overcame. They overcame by the blood of the Lamb. You know, in the 6th century, the Emperor Justinian sent the Roman armies throughout the empire to enforce the prohibition of Passover, to stop it. In his attempt to wipe out the so-called heresy of Passover, thousands of men, women, and children were brutally murdered. You know, entire cities were massacred because they refused to stop celebrating Passover. Why is the devil so scared of Passover? You know, the battle for the Passover has many casualties. Pressurized by the government, the Roman Church joined in the attempts to stamp out Passover. Some of the decrees passed by various church councils, the councils of Antioch in 345 AD, if any bishop, presbyter, or deacon will dare, after this decree, celebrate Passover, the council judges them to be cursed and excommunicated from the church. Hey, you know, what's going on here? Satan always tries, you see. We have not yet come to the fullness of Passover. And Satan fears this. When you say, I plead the blood, what is in your mind? You know, what is in your mind? I plead the blood of Jesus. You know, we use terminology, but you can't have faith behind it unless you understand what you're doing. It needs to be retaught, and it needs to be taught to our children, yes. Really young children. You know, the Passover, behold the Lamb of God. John said, the Passover, behold the Lamb of God, the Passover Lamb. You know, by the blood of Jesus, we've been transferred out of one kingdom into another. Because he died and gave his life, we now have been transferred, and the blood is the life of the flesh, is in the blood. We've been transferred from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. Do you believe that? Yes. Well, when you say, I plead the blood, is that what's on your mind? Yes, it is. We've been transferred out of one kingdom into another, and you cannot touch me because of the blood. You see? And it's by the blood, by the giving of the life of Jesus, judgment, you know, has been turned away from us. Because of the blood of Jesus, the power of the enemy has been broken. We are released from bondage, oppression. By the blood of Jesus, we set free to enter into the promises of God. By the blood of Jesus, the Passover, by his stripes, we were healed. There's got to come a new level of faith and understanding of the power of the blood of Jesus. Power of the blood. My father saw Smith Wigglesworth raise the dead by just pleading the blood. But it's not some magic formula. It's the truth behind it, which we know and stand on is firm and it's assured. We are redeemed by the blood of the Lamb out of the power of the enemy. Notice, it's the blood of the Lamb, not the blood of the lion. See? The blood of the Lamb. We must walk in the nature of the Lamb to fully experience Passover. There was not one feeble person among them. Hallelujah. I wasn't really going to go here, there, tonight, but this afternoon, late this afternoon, the Lord said, talk about the blood for a while. You know, to overcome, we have to walk in the nature of the Lamb. And they overcome him by the blood of the Lamb, the word of their testimony. Oh, hallelujah. Okay. The nature of the Lamb. To know Jesus is to know God, right? Because Jesus is the express image of God, right? So, you know, knowing God must be our prime goal. I mean the prime goal, first thing, knowing God. And you know, the natural man cannot conceive the things of God. Knowing God has to be our prime objective. Anything else, and I'll talk more about this tomorrow, but anything else is secondary to that. You say, well, I'm called to be a pastor, a prophet. That's secondary. The prime goal of all of us have a first calling to know Jesus, to know God, and become like him. That is it. If we put the other two the other way around, we're going to mess it up. I'll talk more about that tomorrow. But this is important, you know? Your image of God is everything. How you see God is what you will finally become, whether your image is right or wrong. If you see the Lord as a judge and ready to smack you every time you get something wrong, that's who you will become. Beholding that image, you'll become formed into it. That's why it's important that we really do know God and what he is like. Really important. And it's critical to us. We live our life at the mercy of how we perceive God. God is not religious, but most Christians are. It's how we perceive God, you see. Oh, our picture of the Lord has to be redrawn. You know, Jesus asked the disciples, you know, who do men say that I am? Remember those scriptures? Who do men say that I am? Matthew 16. And some said, oh, you know, John the Baptist. Some say you're Elijah. Others say you're Jeremiah or one of the prophets. You know, they had four distorted images of who Jesus was, you know, and what he was like. You have to, in this whole thing of judgment, and Pastor Joe covered this morning so well, in this whole issue of judgment, it has to be seen because of the kindness of God. If you don't see it, you're really going to come into confusion and doubt. When all else fails, God brings judgment as his last attempt to bring you back to himself. And you know, we have to see. See, God cannot be, it's impossible for God to be anything other than he is. Moses said, you know, you want me to go into the promised land and lead all these people? You know, there are hundreds of gods. What makes you so different from the others? What makes you so glorious? You know, he said, how can I trust you? I don't even know your name. And you want me to go up the promised land and set these people free and take on Pharaoh? You know, he's just one guy with a stick and a stutter. And he said, you want me to go all the way up there and take on Pharaoh? How do I know who you are? What makes you so glorious among all the gods? He said, I'll show you. Show you the difference. Come over here. Put me by the rock and he said, I'll make all my goodness pass before you. That's what makes me glorious. That's what makes me different to all of the other gods. And then Moses said, right, if you don't go with me, I'm not going. I'm only going with the goodness of God. He cannot be anything other than he is. When Ananias and Sapphira dropped dead, he was being the kindest person on the earth. Who knows how further they would have gone and sinned more and more and more. God thinking, I'll take them now before they get their into that any deeper. He cannot be anything. Love, goodness, kindness. We have to see and redraw a picture of the Lord and how he is. And then the Lord said to Simon Peter, Peter, who do you say that I am? He said, Lord, you are the Christ. You are the Christos, the Son of the living God. You are the anointed one that will reveal the Father. That picture, Jesus said, on that I will build my church. On that, you see, he drew a picture of the Messiah and the goodness of the Messiah. He said, on that I will build my church. On the goodness, a manifestation of the goodness of God. You see, you become like what you worship. And so you go be careful you draw the right picture of the Lord in your worship. I'm serious. You know, the fruit of the Spirit is who Jesus is. The Beatitudes are the basic kingdom laws. The Beatitudes are beautiful attitudes. That's the basic laws of the kingdom. How many sermons do you hear on the Beatitudes? We don't want to hear about God in the second mile, do we? The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, all of those things. That's who Jesus is, and that's who you are supposed to be. You see? That's the Spirit of Christ. Is that your image of Jesus? You know? You need a powerful revelation. It's not enough just to hear this from me. You really need a powerful revelation in your own heart that you know God. You know what he is like. No matter what's going on, and he'll test you on it. When everything goes wrong, you still think God is good. He knows what he's doing. He loves me. He's trying his the very, very best at this time in my life. That's what he's doing to me. No matter what's happening. See, your testimony is very, very important. Because they're overcome with the testimony you have of who God is. Oh, yes. I will build my church. Beholding him, you are changed. You see 2 Corinthians 3:18, we know the scripture. on an open face, beholding the Lord as in the glass, we are changed into the same image. You'll be changed into the image you have of the Lord. But think about that. You know? And the more you behold Him, the more you become like Him. See, this is grace. It's not works. The more you understand what God is like, the more you become like that. Are you listening to me? It's not striving. This is grace. The more you know what God is like by revelation. You see, revelation carries with it all the equipment you need to walk in that revelation. Everything you need is in the revelation for you to walk in it. The revelation comes with power and grace for you to walk in it. So as you see the Lord and begin to see what He is like, then grace is released to you to walk in that, and you become like that. You're changed from one level of glory to another, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. You know? The more you become like Him, the more understanding and wisdom you have. You know, wisdom's a person. Jesus. You know, Colossians 3:10 tells us to put on the new man, which is renewed or transformed after the knowledge of the image of Him. You getting this? Put on the new man, which is renewed after the revelation, epinosis, knowledge, after the revelation of the image of Him that created him. You see, knowledge is gained. That word, epinosis, is a Greek word for this word. And it says that epinosis is revelation received by encountering the source of the revelation. That's what the Greek word means. And when you make that encounter, it's not just revelation. I see it. It's more than that. It's more powerful than that. With it comes everything you need to walk in it. Everything you need to walk in that revelation. To walk in that understanding. Now, your new man. What is your new man? Who is that? It's your spirit, not your soul. Your soul is not the new creation. Your soul becomes a problem to the new creation. Okay? The new man, new creation. The new man or your spirit is changed to the degree that we know what God is truly like. Let me say that again, because I'm saying this stuff quick. It takes me a long time to learn this. You're a new creation man. You're born again, but it is changed to the degree that we understand and know what God is like. That word, you know, it says, and put on a new man, which is renewed in the knowledge after the image of Him. That word renewed is a Greek word, which means to be conformed to and to become like. And it's an important word. You know, the Bible says that the body without your spirit is dead, right? Now, if an angel came along tonight and said, okay, I'm just going to take your spirit out, your body would collapse. Your spirit powers your whole body, powers your heart, your brain. The life in your spirit powers up the physical body. The body without the spirit is dead, right? Now, how much life you have in the spirit is going to affect your body. And we need to understand this. You see, you came from heaven as a spirit, just a spirit, not a son of God. Just a spirit. Lots of spirits in heaven. Full of them. Little ones, big ones, all kinds of spirits, okay? You came from heaven as a spirit, but not a son of God, just a spirit. You have an opportunity to become a son of God. Every person that is born into this world comes with a spirit from heaven. You say, well, what about the unsaved? We'll come to that in a minute, but it just messes theology up a bit more. But anyway, comes from heaven as a spirit. When you are born again, something in your spirit profoundly changes. That spirit came from heaven, wasn't the Son of God, just a created spirit, been there a long time, has an opportunity to come. When you accept Jesus and you are born again, it's not your soul that's born again, it's not your body that's born again, it's your spirit. And becomes a new creation, a new kind of creature, which it was not up there before you came here and were born again. Are you following me? Yes. I want you to get this image in your mind. You became a new creation, you know? Now that spirit, born again by the Spirit of God, has to grow into the likeness of Jesus. You become a new creation, a new creature. Behold, as you know him, beholding him, what he is like, affects changes in your inner man. Your spirit starts to become like the Lord. It's your spirit, not your soul. Your spirit starts to become like Jesus. Beholding him, change starts to occur. You know, growth of your spirit also affects you physically. We'll come to that later. You know, there are at least three levels of revelation. The outer court, certain mild revelation, you know, on the word. Evangelicals, they have the word and they understand some of the word. But there is much more layers in the word than what's on the surface. So you come into the holy place and you have the candlestick, you know, and it's giving light on the bread, the word. And that's good. You have a little more revelation and understanding. But there's another dimension of revelation that's in the holiest of all. It goes deeper, you see. And as you start to hunger after God, you hunger for more reality of him in this world, you begin to be taken from one level to another. But in the final area, you begin to be opened up to the mysteries of the kingdom of God and the mysteries of the universe. That's a totally different level. Totally different level. You begin to understand the eternal purposes of God on that level. Much deeper than just what's at the surface of the Word of God. And, you know, in the Word of God, there are many levels of understanding in the surface. But we just tend to go on the top surface and we don't see the deeper levels. You know, when that angel took me through that waterfall, I said, when it came out of that again, I said, there's got to be a scripture for this, you know. And this angel looked at me as if I should have known. Haven't you, he said, read this scripture, deep calleth unto deep, at the noise of the water spouts. I thought, oh yeah. So that later I looked at that scripture and I looked at the Hebrew and I looked at the whole thing, deep calleth unto deep. At the noise, that word water spouts is a really bad interpretation. Literally it means deep calleth unto deep at the noise of falling water. But you never see that on the surface. Deep calling you further in. You see, into the realms of God and the realms of the Spirit. Oh, glory to God. Ask, seek, knock, press in, and you won't be denied. It's your, you know, your, it's your spiritual perception of God that changes your position of how you stand before God and how you stand before the enemy. You understand what I'm saying? We can stand before God, you know, in the outer courts of the heaven. A lot of people, Revelation being written on paradise, a lot of books, particularly in the past, and they're good. That's great. Gives us understanding. But that's very low level. Deep calls unto deep. There is much, much more. And it's like, you know, Pastor Joe was saying this morning, we're not alone in the universe. We really aren't. Believe me, I've been there. You are so privileged to be able to come here. This is the only fallen world out there that's hard enough to produce sons of God. Spirits, there are many worlds out there with parts of God, many of God's creation living on them. Beautiful worlds, fabulous worlds, beautiful people, never known sin, never known temptation, never known anything of evil. But very low developed because they haven't gone through the hard times and the difficulties that we have here. This planet was developed just for you. The hard times, the hardness of it. Perfect. Glory to God. Hallelujah. They overcame by the blood of the Lamb. Now we overcome the enemy by walking in the nature of the Lamb. We overcome evil with good. See, and so God said, when my judgments are in the earth, I will pass over you. You need to know the power of Passover. I will pass over you. Death was all through Egypt. Children of God with the blood on the doorpost didn't come near them. Their firstborn didn't die. The plagues that came didn't come on them. There was a Goshen, a place of safety right in the middle of it all, which none of this stuff touched. We're going to have Goshens all over this nation. I tell you, I will pass over your understanding it, the revelation of it, being transported but from the blood of Jesus out of one kingdom into another. And walking in that kingdom now while on the earth, nothing shall come near you. The blood of Jesus, the power of the blood. You see, it's a covenant sealed by his blood. You know, in the old times, you used to make covenants between people and clans that they cut a vein, the other one cut a vein, they drop the blood together. And they say, I will stand with you for the rest of your life. That's a blood covenant. But Jesus made a blood covenant with us. He said, I'm going to stand with you. I'll never leave you, nor will I forsake you, right to the end. That's a blood covenant. Hallelujah. You know, in the 80s, I was praying in a forest, a pine forest, about 1,000-acre pine forest. And I used to go in there and hide and pray, you know. And I was praying one day, and this angel came to me. I saw him walking through the trees, and I thought, he must be a warden. But then he got closer, and that's no warden, you know. So this angel came up to me and said, you're going to receive an invitation to do a crusade in Pakistan, and you are to accept it. I thought, Pakistan. I said, Isn't that where they kill Christians? I said, you know, he said, you are to accept it, and when you do, I will come with you. And I thought, I don't know a living soul in Pakistan. No one in Pakistan knows I exist. I'm pretty safe. I'm not going to get an invitation. So, you know, 3 weeks later, I get this letter in the mail. It must have been already on the way when this angel talked to me. When you come to Pakistan, do a crusade. I never heard of these people, didn't know who they were, what it was about. Now, in those days, there's a law in Pakistan against proselytizing. If you witness to a person, they have a legal right to kill you. And they all carry guns. I thought, well, that's nice, isn't it? And I said, well, I've got the Lord with me, and I've got this angel with me, you know. And I said, Lord, this is an Islamic country. What do I tell them? What do you preach? You know? What shall I tell them? The Lord said, tell them just exactly who I am and what I am like, and I will confirm your word. Simple as that. I thought, oh, brother. So I arrive in Pakistan. It's like, you know, in those days, it was really, well, it's still rough today, but it was pretty rough. And we started meetings with about 200 Christians in a courtyard with high walls. So I just began to tell them, and these were Christians, so I thought I'm pretty safe here. Anyway, I gave them the same message, who Jesus is, what he is like, and time to pray for the sick. And God started to heal them. I mean, blind people. And I thought, well, this isn't happening at home. And that went on for a week, and we saw incredible miracles. These were Christians. I thought, right. And then the pastor said, right, we're going to Lahore, which is right up the north on the Afghanistan border. And I said, oh, you didn't tell me that, however. We'll go. So we get up there, and they said, we've hired a football stadium. I'm thinking, 200 people, a football stadium. This doesn't match. I said, are you sure, your football stadium? How many does it seat? 25,000. Oh, 200 people. Okay, so we get there and I start to preach. Same message, who Jesus is, very, very, you know, and what he is like. And the Lord said, I will confirm your word. So, 200 people we go, here we are, first night, 200 people. You know what 200 people looks like in a stadium that seats 25,000? I said, Lord, fill all the other seats with angels, you know. I still started to preach. Within 3 days, we had 12,000. By the end of the week, we had 25,000. And all I was telling them who Jesus was, I didn't speak against Islam or anything. I just said who Jesus was, right from the beginning up to there, who Jesus was and what he is like. And I'd say at the end, now he wants to be like that with you tonight. How many people are blind? and hands went up. So I pray, simple prayer, mainly casting out the demons of blindness, and people would scream. Every time somebody screamed, I thought, another set of eyes opened. Then they all came up, gave their testimony. That started happening night after night. Leprosy. God healing people of leprosy. People not just healed of leprosy, but when they're deformed with leprosy, like no nose and no finger, those growing back. Not slowly, but instantly. And I thought, my goodness me. This went on to the end of the week. And I could not believe the things that happened there. I mean, it's another story to tell you the whole thing, how so many came to the Lord. Now, I don't know where those people are today because I've never been back. But the Lord said, tomorrow night, you close this down. And I said to the pastors, tomorrow night, we close this down or we go back to Karachi. They said, no, brother, it's just going fine, you know. I said, tomorrow, this angel told me we could close it. And I said, you can stay, but I'm going. And I said, when we close it down, the last service we close, we go straight from the meeting to the airport. Angel said, there'll be a plane, we can get on it and go. And I made sure they understood the instructions. So, preached the last one, glorious things going on. I said, remember, we are leaving now, and we're going for the airport. I want to see the car, this side door, and we're going now. As we were going, the army was entering the other door to arrest us. God is only strong, you know? Yet God is only strong. All I did was tell them who Jesus was and what he is like and then prayed for them. And that's your job. Demonstrate and show what Jesus looks like to the world. That's your job. Your job. Everyone's job. That's your job. No matter what vocation you're in, that's your job. You know, it's not complicated. Tell them what God is like in Jesus. And say, I'll show you what God is like. I mean, you know, it's far, far, far easier to get the unsaved healed than it is to get Christians healed. I came back to my church and I couldn't get anyone healed. I thought, you know, God confirmed his word, the gospel of the kingdom with signs and wonders. That's your job, you know, wherever you are in the world, whatever vocation you're in, demonstrating to the people who Jesus is. Not complicated. You say, what's my ministry? Showing Jesus, showing the people what Jesus is like. Not complicated, not rocket science. And there may be various aspects in society that God puts you to do this. That's okay. If you're a doctor, just telling them about Jesus, show them what he is like. If you're a nurse, you work in an office, you work in a government department, you might get fired, but keep it up anyway. You know, that's your job. You can conform to his image. Becoming like him, who he is. Oh, hallelujah. The key word for this time is fullness. From now on, God's going to increase every Passover from now on. God's going to introduce another level of Passover, which will become available to us. Until we finally reach the last one, walking out of Egypt with not one feeble person. Do you believe that? Well, the word is the word. If you believe it, it's true for you. If you don't, it's not true for you. It's as simple as that. You say, well, I tried it and it doesn't work. Keep trying. Keep believing. Keep pressing in. One day you'll break through. You know, it takes the space shuttle huge amount of fuel to just get into orbit. But once it's in orbit, hardly uses anything, any fuel to whip around, you know. It's like this. Once you break through, you get into orbit. You can walk in that. Getting through takes time, takes prayer, keeps refusing to be denied. You have to keep pressing in. You have to keep seeking. And you break through, then it's easy to maintain after that. And it's a process, you know. Pentecost. Next time Pentecost comes around, it's going to release another higher dimension of the fire of God. That's what he told me. That each one will be more available. Oh, how we need the fire of God. Clean up the mess. Once the fire of God falls, you'll be surprised how many demons are in Christians. Don't look at me like that. Your spirit might be regenerated, but your soul is not. Yes. Oh boy. Demons hate the fire. It's possible. And it's coming. It's coming. Clean up time. There's a level of the fire of God. It's not the top level, but there's a level of the fire of God that will take you out for several hours at a time. You'll just be gone while he deals with you. You'll get out of that a few hours later, a very different person. You see, it's your soul that sins, not your spirit. He said, you've got something in here that cannot sin. It certainly isn't your soul, your mind, your emotions, and your will. That's got to be dealt with another way, all right? And, yeah, I'll go there. Why not? You're three distinct, you know, your body, soul, and spirit, right? Every person who comes into this world has a spirit. Listen to me. I'm going to mess your theology up now. When they die, whether they're born again or not, their spirit returns to God. That's what the Bible says. But your soul could go to hell. You know, why would I want to come here as a spirit if there was the chance of me being, that spirit being lost and going to hell? I'd pass up that chance. I wouldn't take the risk. You hear what I'm saying? You were sent here and you wanted to come. But if there's a chance of that spirit being lost eternally, I would have said I pass. I won't take the risk. You with me?
Yes.
Okay, spirit return. But the soul is a different matter altogether. You see, Brother Sider was talking about the three differences, the three identities, spirit, soul, and body. And it can stand alone. You know? I have email after email from people who say, you came into our cell group and you taught us for a while. And I say, well, what is that? I wasn't even aware of it. I'm probably asleep. You don't realize what you get up to when you're asleep. I'm serious. It's all in the scripture. Oh, we've got to grow up. You know, we can't stay where we are. We've got to grow up in our understanding, you know, releasing the baptism of the fire. And finally, we come into the, not finally tonight, because I'm not quitting yet, but finally in this, when we, this year, when the Feast of Tabernacles breaks, you've got to believe God to take you in a process of bringing you into perfect rest. That's the first aspect of the Feast of Tabernacles to be released. And if you do not walk in rest, you won't survive what's coming. There's got to be a peace and a rest, no matter what's going on around us. The devil does not know what to do with a person who has perfect peace. He can't handle it. That's the first aspect of the Feast of Tabernacles that's going to be released. Until finally, year after year, for the next 7 years, we're going to see the fullness of the feast finally fully released. That's what I was told. You're going to see the final fullness of the feast released. Ooh, we have no idea what means Christ in us in its fullness, in his fullness. Christ in us. One of the most shocking concepts for the Old Testament saints was the concept of Christ in us, the Messiah in us. That was really difficult for them to understand that. You know? How can that be? You know, how can that be? You know, humanity is not a whole mob of individuals. That's not what humanity is. Humanity is one tree with many branches. And if the first one gets it wrong in the family tree, all the rest have got it wrong. Right? Like begets like. So something, you know, had to change. It's one body, one tree, one family tree. Adam stood as the prototype, if you like, for all that would come after him. He was the pattern, body, soul, and spirit. He was the pattern for everyone that would come after him. The problem is, see, he kind of messed it up a bit. And it is, you know, he was the head of all coming human race. But when he fell, see, there were two trees in the garden. I believe if Adam hadn't fell, he would have taken into the tree of life and he would have lived forever. And you would have produced a human race that it would live forever. But that was not the case. He had to go through the tests first. And he failed. Okay. His actual DNA changed. Okay. He was made in the image and likeness of God, body, soul, and spirit. Perfect. It says God formed them out of dust, he formed them out. When he breathed the human spirit into him, he powered up and became a living soul. Okay. But when he literally bowed to Lucifer, there was a radical change took place. He had a fallen nature. He had another DNA, and everyone who was going to come after him would have the same. That's why in John 8, 30, 43 and 44 it says, "Why do you not understand my speech?" Jesus said, "Even because you cannot hear my word. You are of your father who? The devil." Well, that's nice, isn't it? "You are of your father the devil? And the lusts of the father you will do. He was a murderer from the beginning." So on. Wow. "You're of your father, the devil." It wasn't long before Adam and Eve had children, and one of them killed his brother. What happened? Adam was in the image and likeness of God. Let us make man in our own image and likeness. Something terrible took place. It says, the first man, Adam, was made a living soul. The last Adam, Jesus, was made a quickening spirit. Eve was in the likeness and image of God. But you see, when Eve conceived, there was a perfect fetus formed. But when the child was born, this is what the scripture says. It goes on to say, and Adam lived 130 years and begat a son in his own image. No longer in that image. He begat a son in Adam's image and likeness. See the change? There, that started something. In his image, called his name, Seth. And the days after Adam had begotten Seth were 800 years, and he begat sons and daughters, all in the image of Adam. Not God. There were inner changes took place. Oh, when you are born again, see, this spirit, you as a spirit, came from heaven. It could have been there for eons and eons. When you came here, you were not a son of God. You were a spirit, right? Don't look at me like that. You came into a physical body. Okay? Your human spirit tried to influence you greatly to come to the Lord. Didn't always achieve it, but when you were born again, what happened? What changed within? That spirit, which is not a son of God, child of God, it was just a spirit, was it imparted with the DNA of God. Spiritual DNA into your spirit. And you became a whole new creation. No longer human. Now, don't go around telling you people you're not human. But you know, that is the fact. And he said, that which has changed within you, that which you've become now, the seed of God in you, cannot sin. It used to puzzle me, that verse. You know, I cannot sin. I thought, well, I definitely missed it. You know? And Adam brought forth a son in his own image and likeness. Looked the right shape, the babies looked the right shape, looked right, but in the inside there was something terribly wrong. The soul that sins, it shall die. So who are you? Who are you? Hey, who are you? When Jesus came to this earth, he came as a spirit. He returned as a totally different being. He had a resurrection body. He was a new creation. And we are his children. Are you getting this? Oh, hallelujah. You say, well, people in the Old Testament, you know, who were faithful to God, where did they go? Have you thought about that? Where did they go? I mean, they weren't born again, were they? It couldn't be until Jesus came, paid the price for sin, and started a new race of people. So where did they go? They went down, not up. I was teaching this in a Bible school once, and they nearly threw me out. That's why... You know, they can't go to heaven, not yet anyway, not until Jesus dies on the cross. Have you thought about that? You know, remember Abraham? Remember, Luke chapter 16, and it came to pass that this beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And in hell, this rich man lifted up his eyes, being in torments, but he could still see Abraham afar off, and Lazarus with him. And he cried, saying, O Father Abraham, have mercy on me. Send Lazarus that he might dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in your lifetime received your good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he's comforted and you are tormented. And he said, and besides all this, there is a great gulf fixed between us, and we can't pass over. That wasn't in heaven. That was in the earth. You know? Sheol. Oh. When Jesus died on the cross, where did he go? Up or down? You see? Ephesians 4:8. Wherefore he saith, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive, gave gifts to men. Now he that ascended, what is it also that he first descended into the lower parts of the earth? Took the keys of death and hell. Opened the door. They weren't in hell, you know, they were in a place of waiting. Opened the door, they came out, and many of them walked on the streets of Jerusalem. And the people saw them and talked to them. How about that? Now, that's going to freak them out, you know. And into heaven. The price had been paid. You know, and it says in 1 Peter 3:18, for Christ also once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring to us to God, being put to death in the flesh, being quickened in the spirit, by which also he went and preached to the spirits in prison. He descended into the earth and said, I've done it. Hallelujah. It's finished. Hallelujah. Some of you look at me like I'm off the wall or something. But see, what was needed, because the race was in a mess, they needed someone who was perfect now, who could start a new race. Because the old race was totally contaminated by Adam all the way down. But there was no perfect human being. So God had a brilliant idea. He said, I'll send my son as a spirit and he'll put him in a girl, 17-year-old girl. Your spirit comes into us. His spirit went into her, you know, his spirit. And Mary thought, didn't really know what was going on, what was taking place, you know. It says in Luke 1:30, Mary said to the angel, how shall this thing be? Saying, I know no man. Well, it can't be born, you see, from human beings. They can't have a birth between two human beings, because that continues the Adamic line, which is corrupted. So the angel answered and said to her, the Holy Ghost shall come upon you, and the power of the highest shall overshadow you. Therefore that holy thing which shall be born on thee shall be called the Son of God. God took a perfect spirit, Jesus, and said he's got to come into the human line. It cannot be by relationship between a man and a woman. That would contaminate the whole Adamic line. Just keep it going. But spirit came into Mary. You know when you have babies? Well, you know when you have babies. But, you know, have you seen these kids that lie in the cot and they're talking things? What are they doing? What are they seeing? More than you realize. They just brand new out of heaven. And now they're confined in a body which they can't express themselves through. You know, these are not tiddly little baby spirits that come. They are mature spirits. Suddenly locked into this size. Jesus came You know, my grandchildren, when they were very, very little, I heard this. They told some of them earlier here, but they didn't know I was there. They were really little, and they were talking together, girl and boy. And they were saying, going like this, "Can you remember before we came here, the trees were so different. The sky was different. And can you remember? And the house we lived in." And they would say, "Yes, I remember that. And remember this, remember this, remember that." And I said, "This is, they didn't know I was there. These are little kids, don't know anything." But time erases. The brain takes over. Time erases it out. But they remembered for a while. I heard them later. The boy was saying this, "I can't remember it all. Can you remember?" To the younger one, "Tell me about it again." See? Jesus came. And it was a 17-year-old girl. Sinless. On the cross, he took the sin of the world, past, present, and future, and laid it upon himself. It was laid upon him. He paid the price. The wages of sin is death. We have no idea what that would have felt like. Every disease known to man was laid upon him. By his stripes we were healed. He came. He rose again, a new creation. He wasn't the same as when he came. He's now different. He has a resurrection body, the first of a new kind of species in the universe, a new creation. This was always the plan of God, to have sons and daughters as a new creation, but Adam fouled it up. You are born again by the Spirit of God. You have his DNA. It says you're born again by the, I might better read it or I'll misquote it. But you see, it's like Christ, God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself. You're born again of the seed of God. Think about it. The Greek word is sperm. Sperma in the Greek. You are born again. When you're born again, his seed entered your spirit and you changed. It said that seed cannot sin. But your soul will go on sinning if you don't take charge of it. You know, Satan was really upset because he heard all these prophecies, you know. And he knew what God had said in the Garden of Eden, the seed of the woman would bruise your head, right? And this little royal line works its way all the way through up to Jesus. And it's interesting, remember, the harlot in when Joseph took Jericho and she lied about it, he said, "I'm going to reward you by putting you in the line of Christ." And the line goes all the way up to Christ. I wouldn't have done that, would you? Isn't God good? Hey, you gotta wise up a bit, you know? You gotta realize who you are. You're a new creation. Herod tries to kill all the babies in Jerusalem, the surrounding areas. That was a huge massacre. It was prophesied in the Old Testament. It was a huge massacre. He thought, "I'll kill every baby so this thing's not gonna come to pass." Didn't realize. All he was doing is producing seed for a harvest that was to come after Pentecost. It says, you know, if the princes of that world had known they wouldn't have crucified Jesus. That's the Bible says. The princes of the world, no, they wouldn't have crucified him. Oh, seed. Jesus, by this time, was out of the way in Egypt, because Joseph had had a dream and said, take him to Egypt, out of the way. So Jesus walks the earth, showing us what this new creation is supposed to be like. This is what you're supposed to be like. This is your job. You walk the earth, healing the sick, revealing what God was like, a picture of a new creation, picture of what the next human race would be like. He rose from the dead, started a new race of people, a new creation. The righteous old in the Old Testament, which were taken out from the Old Testament, taken to heaven. Boy, that must have upset Satan. Oh, he rose from the dead. When you were born again, you were born of the seed of God. 1 Peter 1:21, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible seed. That's DNA. By the word of God, which lives and abides forever, and whosoever is born of God does not commit sin, for his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin because it is the seed of God. Something in your spirit cannot sin. Oh. The thing is, you see, when you were born again, you all became schizophrenic. Seriously. You all were schizophrenic. Just as well as not on your medical record. That's what happened. Your spirit has got the life and the nature of God in it. But your soul is rebelling. It's had its own way ever since you were born. Your mind, emotions, and will, your soul wants to do its own thing. And there's a clash straight away. And a lot of Christians stay schizophrenic. They really do. One has to die, and the other has to live, and you get to choose which one. Okay? Your soul is saved, and can be saved, but it's a process. You have purified your soul by obedience, the Bible tells us. It's a process. You purify your soul by obedience to God's word. That's a process. But your spirit is already there. If the two ends eventually match up, and there's a harmony between your soul, your mind, emotion, and will, and your spirit, you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done. And when your spirit and your mind, your heart and your mind agree, you'll start to be into the process of transfiguration. With Jesus, it was instant, but with us, it's gradual. Because the mind, the Bible says the natural mind is an enemy of God. Enmity, the word is enmity in the Bible, it means enemy. That's how strong it is. But when every morning I get up, I come to the Lord before I do anything. I ask the Lord to cleanse and renew my mind every single day. You watch pictures on TV, it lodges in your memories. You hear stuff, you look at stuff. Every day I come before the Lord and I say, Lord, lay your hands on me. Renew my mind. Then I say, Lord, cleanse my eyes. And they say, Lord, clean out the dirt in my ear. Spiritually, we hear stuff all day, you know. Then they say, Lord, cleanse my mouth. And only then I find can I start to enter in to the presence of the Lord in any real marked way. You see, Peter said, you know, he said, you know, cleanse my feet and so on. He said, Lord, wash me all, he said. He said, I just need to wash your feet. The stuff that touches the ground, this earth, that's all you need cleansing from. He said, no, cleanse me all. He said, no, your feet's enough, he said to Pete. You need to do that every day. But you see, the mind needs to be renewed because it needs to think as God thinks. It needs to understand who God is and what he is like by revelation. And the two need to sync. Because this runs interference with what you've got in here. It doesn't think like that. The two are different. And the more your mind is renewed and spending time in the presence of the Lord, just in the presence of the Lord, starts to renew your mind. Beholding him, you become like him. You see, something takes place within you, starts to change, starts to be renewed. You know, and it's like when you see him, you shall be like him. That's an eternal principle. Changes take place. The soul is renewed. And when you get to that point where the two are becoming compatible, the problem with us and God is incompatibility. Spirit is compatible because he that is joined to the Lord is one spirit. Right? That's what the Bible says, right? Okay. This is a problem, incompatibility between the two. When this starts to change, listen to me, when this starts to change, the soul starts to change, the life begins to flow into your physical body. It has to flow through the soul into your body. That process. And that's when transfiguration starts to get underway. Now, if you understand this and you start to go for it, you'll start to change. Oh, you know, we really don't understand the power of choice. The old nature has to die. And it will only do that if you choose daily. You don't let the old, you choose not to be that way. And when you choose, something in your spirit is sparked and changes you in your soul. Something in the soul dies, and that's renewed in your soul every time you choose right. It's grace. You just have to choose, and the rest is grace. The power is released. And it's a process of choosing. Yield not your members to unrighteousness, the Bible says. Choose what is right. The power of choice is so powerful of what it releases. You still have a free will. And as your soul agrees with your spirit, and you choose from your soul level not to do that anymore, empowerment takes place from your spirit and takes it over. And that's where Paul said, I've been crucified with Christ. Your soul life. Two of you can't live together. It's not that your soul dies. It loses its independence. Something else happens. The creativity level, when the soul dies, reaches enormous proportions in your soul. Oh, hallelujah. You know, you listen to some music in the world and it's very enlightening. It's not Christian music, but it's good. It comes through inspiration from their spirit. Not always. Some music is really demonic. But the unsaved have also produced some very good music. I used to ponder this, you know. And my grandmother, the old Salvation Army officer, said, you can't listen to the radio, you know. And she's probably right in most of the time. But some stuff, there's some artists out there in the world, not Christians, who produce beautiful stuff. Because the inspiration came from their spirit, not their soul. And some of these musicians can either move from their spirit, or they can move from the demonic. I mean, believe you me, we had most of our musicians in the early church came out of rock bands in the early times, saved out of rock bands, you know. And I used to say to them, how could you play like that for hours without even thinking of how you're playing that guitar? It's supernatural. He said, we get into a place where we ascend into another dimension. And I thought, yeah, that's right, into the demonic. But when we got them cleaned up, they made fabulous musicians. They get way in the spirit of God, I tell you. And then, you see, spirit is inspirational. It's part talent, but there's another dimension to it, where you pass your talent and you're into another level, where you're doing stuff which you couldn't naturally do on a musical instrument. That's the spirit of God in you. Oh, it's a transcending. You know, and I said, well, these guys, how did you get into that realm? Drugs. If we had enough drugs, we can transcend into the demonic and play anything for hours, supernaturally. Hey. But sometimes music came out of unsaved people, out of their spirit. It was inspirational. You know, you can't say, oh, unless it's Christian music, it's not good. Come on, don't be so religious. Some secular music is quite good. Don't look at me like that. We've got to grow up, you know, in our understanding. You know, the key word was choose. Adam fell by choice. The way we come back is by choice. The soul that sins, it shall die. You choose not to live that way. You choose not to do those things. It's not striving not to do them. You choose, and then the power enables and grace. It's just a matter of choice. And if you keep doing the right choices, your soul will be purified. Choosing not to sin has incredible power behind it. You have to know what God's like. Oh, hallelujah. How far do we go? What's the time? Okay. Growing up is going to be fast-tracked now. It's going to be fast-tracked, and we've got to stay up with it. You know? It's going to be one test after another. We've got to pass. You know? Until it all becomes internalized. All about growing up. You have in you everything that you need to fulfill your destiny. When you were born again, it was planted in your spirit. Everything you need. You are complete now. You know, we're always asking, Lord, come. You are complete now. It's learning to walk in it is half the problem. You're complete. You have everything you need to fulfill your destiny. Why you came here, it was already in the package. And you were born again. You came with it as a spirit from heaven. A little package. God says, this is your destiny. You agreed to it. He said, okay, I'll agree to that. This is the kind of life I will have on earth. Okay. These are my parents. Fine. I agree to that. This is the package you'll take with you to fulfill your destiny.